Good Friday was necessary to save us from a bad eternity. This day is the most important day in history because this day God solved sin. For God so loved the world that he gave himself. And if you can believe on what he did for you, you shall be saved. You don't have to be separated from God anymore because of one day. I want to begin by making a few statements about Easter. Easter is not for the church. Easter is for the world. Good Friday is not for us, because we already believe. Here's a verse of scripture you are all familiar with, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world. This weekend is about the world. It was about me and you when we were in the world, a part of the system, corrupted by its spirit, controlled by its power. And it was the actions of Easter that gave us the ability to be set free from that power. And now we must continue to keep sharing the good news with those who are still locked up in bondage by the world system. The birth and death of death. Death was given birth and death was killed. The king came to accomplish that, and he did it to redeem kings. Let me begin with a statement about our faith. There are four major religions in the world, and many smaller ones. Of all the major religions of the world, including Islam, Hinduism, and Buddhism, Christianity is the only faith in which the founder personally died for his followers. This is very important. That distinguishes the Christian faith from every other so-called religion. Buddha did not die for the Buddhists. Muhammad did not die for the Muslims. Confucius did not die for the Confucians. Maharaja did not die for the Hindus. They wrote wise sayings. They wrote books. They established different systems of traditions for the people to follow, and they gave them all kinds of acts to perform. But not one of them died for their followers. Secondly, no other faith on earth promises the cleansing of personal and corporate sin through the personal sacrifice of its founder. Muhammad never claims that his death and his blood would forgive the sins of the Muslim. Buddha never once suggested that his life, as pure as he claimed it was, could in any way affect the personal and corporate sin of the Buddhists. No guru or Maharaja has ever claimed that their life and their purity, including the one who is alive today, that their life could forgive and cleanse the sins of their followers. Only this Christ faith, Jesus said, I lay my life down to atone for many. In other words, I'm going to die to cleanse the people who follow me. No other faith claims that. The Buddhist reads good scripture from the writings of Buddha and learns some wisdom. But the Buddhist has no guarantee that his sins are taken care of. The Muslim reads the Quran and studies the great writings of Muhammad, fasts, and visits Mecca, and goes through the different traditions of Muslim every year, but has no guarantee that his sins are solved. You shouldn't get caught dead without knowing your sins were solved. Look, I don't want to be faithful and committed to a religion if it doesn't solve my sin consciousness. That's why this faith, the Christian faith, is in a class all by itself. What other founder of a religion has ever said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do? No other. Every other religion is built on the founder claiming he got some prophecy or some revelation. This is the only faith where the life of the founder is the foundation of the faith. No other founder of any religion ever commanded their followers to follow them. Muhammad never demanded that Muslims follow him. He told them to submit to God. Matter of fact, that's what Islam means. The word Islam means submission. No Hindu has ever been commanded by any Maharaja to follow him. He would say, follow these wise sayings, but not me. Muhammad never demanded a Buddhist to follow in his footsteps and be like him. He said, follow these nice sayings. But Jesus, in a class all by himself, said, if any man will come after me, he must deny himself and decide to die to himself and follow me. And then he said, for he that have me have life. What kind of demand is that? And he said, he that does not have me does not know life. John 3 verse 36 says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever rejects the Son will not see life. Instead, the wrath of God remains on him. Jesus never told you to go after God. He commanded you to come after him. This man's life and death, incarnation and resurrection is the foundation of this faith. Why did Jesus have to die? This is an important question. It's a logical question. Why did this man have to die to redeem humanity? God created the whole universe. God is powerful. God produced what the scientists have discovered. They say they have discovered that there are over 100 billion galaxies. They have also discovered that there are possibly more universes. They have lost the ability to count the planets and the stars. And the Bible says all of that was created by God. How can a God who made 100 billion galaxies and keep them all running and prevent them from clashing into each other cannot save a few puny human beings without killing a man? Why couldn't God just snap his finger and we are redeemed? After all, according to the Bible, he holds all the stars between his little finger and his thumb. He holds the universe in the palm of his hand, and our scientists' telescopes can't measure it all. What a big hand! Don't you think we should obey someone that big? Don't let God slap you. If God could raise the dead by speaking to the dead, why couldn't he redeem you by talking redemption to you? Why does there have to be a bloody passion? The critics and the agnostics, the antagonists, hearing this would say, God is sadistic. That means they believe God must love to kill and hurt things, that he is possessed by this spirit to see blood. He is a bloodthirsty God. Boy, this is a strange God you worship. That's what they think about him. Why does the God of the universe have to deal with the death of a man to save men when he made the whole universe? What's wrong with his power? To answer this question, we have to talk about the birth of death. When was death born? First of all, God created man in his image to dominate earth as his agency. We know that. Genesis 1:26 says God created man to dominate the earth as his agent. Very clear. Number two, mankind enjoyed perfect communion and relationship with God in the garden as spiritual beings. Adam never went to a worship service. He never had to sing songs. He never had sacraments. He had no altar. He had no candles. He had no music. He had no tambourines. He didn't have any of this stuff we are doing. And the Bible says he walked and talked with God in the cool of the day. Perfect common union. He was alive unto God. It would be a temptation to believe Satan created death. The truth is, death was not created by Satan. Whenever we think of death in the Christian culture, we think of the devil. We think of death as if Satan created death. And we believe then, therefore, if Satan created death, then if we get rid of Satan, we will get rid of death. But that is not true. And the concept is wrong. And if your theology is built on that, then you will never appreciate why God had to die. So who created death? Genesis chapter 2 tells us death was created by God. Death is not a negative. God created death without life. Death had no life. That's why God never worried about death. He created it, but it had no life. Death was dead. Death was created dead. Number five, death pre-existed Adam, but had no power over Adam. Death existed before Adam. God created death before he created man, but death had no life. Death was present when Adam was in the garden. Number six, God introduced death to man and established the conditions and the limitations of the effects that death can have on man. God wasn't afraid of death, and God wanted Adam to laugh at death. Here's a shocking truth. God created death and gave death to Adam and gave man control over death. God created death and then he created Adam. He gave death to Adam and he gave Adam complete control over death. Adam, you decide what happens to death, whether it stays dead or comes alive. I'm giving you complete power over death. Let me prove this from Scripture. I'm so excited about the power of God. Look at Genesis chapter 2. Look at what God says about death and who he is talking to. There's no mystery in the Bible. Watch this. When death was born, Genesis chapter 2 verse 16, God told Adam, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why? For the day you eat of it, you will activate someone who is already present." Adam did not invent death, created death. Satan did not invent death, created death. Death was always there, present, but useless. God says, "Adam, it's up to you. You can give it life or leave it dead. There is no fear of death in me. I used to be afraid of death. I used to be so afraid of death, I wouldn't go to funerals. And if I did go, I was uncomfortable. Look, if I don't attend your funeral, it's not because I'm afraid of death. I promise you, if you listen to me, young man and young woman, you will never be afraid of death again. Because death was created to be under your control. God gave Adam death. Now you can decide whether it stays dead or comes to life. God said, if you eat from this tree, death is going to come to life. You are in control of death. If you eat, that means death can't do nothing if you don't eat. In other words, death is useless until you give it life. Now watch God. Death is present, but God says, I introduce death to you. There's someone here called death. If you eat from this tree, you are going to activate this guy who is here. Right now, he is present, but hopeless, powerless, useless, ineffective. But he is present. And that's how death is supposed to be all the time. Present, but useless. Write this down, please. Death existed, but had no power. The weakness of death. Death existed inherent in creation. Okay, try to understand it. Did you know death is in everything? Everything that has life has death built into it. Death is life in reverse. You cannot have life without the presence of death. If a plant is alive, death is somewhere in that plant, but it is useless. That's why the plant is alive. God didn't have to create death separately. When God created life, death was life. Oh, I'm talking to myself. Look, the devil is so mad because I've got him by the neck. I got this figured out. See, if you pick up a live plant by the stems, what happens? It hangs on to the soil for dear life. Why? Because that's where it came from. Wherever you came from, you have to stay attached to it. Where's the life? The life is in the plant. Life will continue as long as the plant stays attached to where it came from. But if I pull the plant away from the soil, I don't have to kill it. The death is simply life in reverse. And it is activated when you violate the principle of attachment. If you separate the resource from the source, you don't have to kill the resource. God says, Adam, you and I are joined at the heart. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, death that is present can never kill you. It has no power. Death had no power over man. The submission and obedience of man maintained the powerlessness of death. God says, if you don't eat from that tree, you will live eternally. But if you detach yourself from me, disobey my commands, you violate the attachment principle, and you will surely die. Surely is a deep word. Surely means you don't have to guess about this. Ain't no guessing about this because, matter of fact, I am guaranteeing you that you're dead. Okay, let's go a little deeper. I am going to make sure you die. Man had the power over death. How? Through the obedience to God's word. The power that man had over death was keeping the command of God. That's all you do. Just keep the commandment of God. Death was present, but had no power. Death was weak in that it had no power over obedient man. The key to you living forever is the obedience to the word of God. Again. What did God give Adam to keep death dead? His word. God didn't give Adam no trick. He didn't give Adam no ceremony. He didn't give Adam no religion. He said, look, if you want to keep death dead, just keep my word. Obey my word. Now, Adam messed up and disobeyed God's word. If death came alive when man disobeyed the word of God, then the only way for God to put death back to death is to give man the word again. Here's another verse you've seen before. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And the Word says, if you do what I say, you shall get your life back. You ought to shout hallelujah on Good Friday. Give him a praise for giving you the Word. Praise God. That's why I can't take no chances. I respect Buddha. I can't take no chances with him. I respect Muhammad. But I can't take no chances with him. I respect Baha'u'llah. I can't take no chances with him. I respect Haile Selassie. I can't take no chances with him. Papa Boo Boo? I can't take no chances with him. But this word that came in the flesh, it's the word that messed me up. It's the word that blessed me up. It was the breaking of the word that destroyed me. It was the submission of the word that restored me. The activation of death. Who activated death? Disobedience is called rebellion in the Hebrew language. Very important. Write this down, please. The Hebrew word for disobedience is rebellion. The Hebrew word for rebellion is spelled S-I-N. Sin is not stealing and cursing and carousing and drinking liquor and backbiting and adultery and fornication and killing. That's not sin in the Hebrew language. In the Hebrew culture, the context, the language, sin is simply rebellion against the known will of God. That is called sin. The things I listed are the results of rebellion. They are sinful acts of disobedience. What is disobedience? Rebellion. Disobedience is rebellion to God's known will. Rebellion is called sin. What is disobedience? Rebellion. What is rebellion? Sin. You have to tie them together. Man's disobedience to God's word, which is rebellion to God's command, which is called sin, activated the power of death. Without sin, death has no power. It exists, but has no power. Man's disobedience to God's word, therefore, gave life to death. God told man, death is with you right now, Adam, but it has no life. But if you disobey my command, death will come alive and surely kill you. Man's disobedience gave life to death to kill man. Simple equation. So death killed man because man gave life to death to kill man. Okay, make sure You don't let the devil steal this message. You have to think hard. Sin is the source of the power of death. Death is not a problem. Death is a hopeless, useless, powerless entity. Death is a part of life. Every animal that is alive has death in it. When the animal does certain things against the principle of life, then death comes alive and kills the animal. Hebrews chapter 2 says, "And he, Jesus, tasted death for all men, so that those who were under fear of the power of death could be set free from the fear of death." Jesus didn't come to deal with death. He came to deal with the power of death. Because once you take away the source that is giving death power, death still exists, but has no power. So Paul understood it like I do. Paul says, "Oh, death, I know you are there, but where is your sting?" It's like a wasp who got no sting. He says, "The bee is humming all around you. It's a live bee, but it has no sting." God doesn't get rid of the bee. He just takes the sting out of it again. Paul says, "Oh, grave, you ain't got no control over my body. I'm going to get back up out of the dirt and walk away from the hole." You know, that is going to be a day. I'm telling you, I can't wait for resurrection. You will see the hole behind you. That's why Sunday morning is so important. Sunday morning is proof that Jesus took the sting out and walked out of the hole. Death still existed on Sunday morning, but it had no power to hold him. Hallelujah. Listen to me. Don't let the devil steal this message from you. And listen, if you owe the bank right now, then the bank is a creditor. They control you. You owe them money. When you owe somebody something, they control you. But when you pay them off, the debt is paid in full. Once you pay it off, they ain't got no business contacting you. They ain't got no right to call you. Hallelujah. See, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. So once you pay death its wages, it shouldn't bother you no more. Good Friday was death's payday. Come on. Good Friday is when Jesus went into his pocket on Calvary and paid death. 1, 2, 3, 4. Paid in full. Don't call them no more. Your debt to death was paid. You should go to the grave smiling. Listen to me. When you die, I don't want to hear that you was dying depressed. You tell death, "You ain't got no power over me. I'm coming back." Hallelujah. I'll be back. Good Friday is Jesus dealing with the source of the power of death. What is the source of the power of death? Sin. What is sin? Rebellion. What is rebellion? Disobedience to God's word. Okay, I have a verse for you to write down. Romans 5:12. Let's read it together. "Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, in this way death came to all men, because all sinned." Death gets its power from sin. And if you are a sinner, death gotcha. You were born in sin. So you were born under the power of death. That's why you cannot and should not join a religion that doesn't deal with sin. You don't need no one to teach you no scriptures and quote nothing. Listen, I don't want to sit there chanting and bowing back and forth and chanting, ya-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, and you ain't dealing with the source of my problem. There's no blood in Buddhism. There's no blood in Hinduism. There's no blood in Islam. There's blood in the faith of Christianity because life and death is in the blood. Good Friday is God's final solution. For 4,000 years, God was substituting goats and lambs and birds and oxen. But God says, let me tell you what, let me fix this once and for all. Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. That's why there's no goats in this meeting. There's no lambs in this meeting. No blood on the altar, because there was an altar on Golgotha. Paid in full. Hallelujah. Look at Romans 5, verse 17. For if by the trespass, disobedience, of one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? One man, one disobedient act activated death to kill everybody. Because that one man had everybody in him. Death came alive through disobedience. Okay, read verse 19. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. Go ahead, give God a praise for Good Friday. Hallelujah. See, listen, I don't think you really understand what he did. You got to give God a loud praise. Come on, let the devil hear you. Because you've got the secret now. See, do you know how depressed the devil is today when you begin to rejoice over this? Satan has no power, you know. Satan's only strategy is to get you to sin. Listen to me. You listening? The devil was in the garden. Read the Bible. He was present all the time, but he had no weapon to fight with. He couldn't deal with the man. But when he heard God say to man, this thing, death, is here. See, the devil ain't your problem. The devil was present. And man was walking and talking with God in the cool of the day, with Lucifer all around. Useless, hopeless, no power. But when Lucifer heard God say, the day you disobey me, this thing, death, will kill you. Lucifer's number one assignment became, I've got to get man to disobey God. Then it, not I, will activate death and kill him. And I will sabotage God's program for the creature called man. His agenda hasn't changed. And that's why Jesus calls him the tempter. You see, the devil can't make you sin. Oh, but he is working hard to get you to rebel against God. Everything that is against you right now is trying to get you to do wrong. Now, some of you won't admit that, but my God, mean, everything around you, everybody, every piece of equipment, all the technology, all the phone calls, everything is trying to get you to do something against God. Am I right? Matter of fact, that's why you are fighting the good fight of faith, because there is constant temptation to get you to do wrong. Once you do wrong, then you have activated death again. That's why the Bible says if you sin, you have to quickly confess it before God, and He is faithful and just to do what? Cleanse you right away from all sin. And the blood of Jesus will cleanse you from all sin, which means now death is dead again. Lord have mercy. You don't understand how much power you got. Every day we kill death. Every time you confess and follow God, death is dead again. Dead again. Dead again. Jesus gave you the power to keep killing death and killing death because His blood. Come on, church. You have access to the blood. Praise God. Just raise your hands and thank Him. Thank Him for His blood. Lord, thank You for the blood. Because without the blood, there is no remission. And if sin ain't remitted, then death still got the power. Thank You. Thank You for forgiving me and freeing me from sin. Because when I am cleansed, death is dead again. That's why you shouldn't die in sin. And if you are here in this session or listening to this program online and you ain't born again and you ain't got your sin sorted out, listen to me. Don't you leave this meeting without saying, Lord, I confess. I need You. Forgive me. And give death a death deal. Leave death dead. Then death can't touch you. That's why you should pray every morning, you know, just to make sure death is dead before you go to work. Come on, y'all, talk to me. Devotions is making sure everything is under the blood. Because I want to make sure death's dead. Then, when the car come to hit you, death says, can't touch that one. Hallelujah. When the bucket falls from the roof and all the other people get hurt and you don't, why? Death says, that one? I can't touch that one. I ain't got life to kill that one. I said, I ain't got life to kill that one. I ain't alive to kill that one. That one is covered by the blood. Yeah. Listen, Good Friday is death's nightmare. This day in history is the most depressing day for death. Do you know how you feel when you're present and nobody noticing you? Death says, I am depressed. I'm in the middle of these thousands of people and none of them noticing me. I can't even get their attention. I am dead. I am present, but dead. Come on, give God a praise, because you are under the blood. You are forgiven. There's no sin in your life to give death life. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let's read this together. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 56. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Okay, write these down. These are important to write down for yourself. Oh, death, where is your sting? Paul was asking death, where is your sting? Na 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 boo boo. Paul says to death, look, let me tell you something. Na 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 boo boo. You can't touch this. You were supposed to say on your deathbed, na 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 boo boo. Die saying that. Na 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 boo boo. Come on, just laugh at death. Ha ha ha. Oh, death, I know you are here, but you ain't got no sting. Praise God. Because Good Friday took the sting out. I love Good Friday. Today is a good day to give. You know, the sting of death is gone, which means if there is no sin, sting gone. That's why you got to get saved by the blood of Jesus. Don't you fool with Buddha, Muhammad, or Confucius. Listen, Haile Selassie ain't died for nobody's sin. And if you die without the atonement work of Jesus on your life, you are going to get stinged. When you die, death is going to say, come here. And death is going to sting you. And you are going to die and go to hell. And that's why Jesus died for you. So death cannot sting you. That's why he had to die to deal with this sting problem. All right, I'm going to show you in this brief moment why man had to die. Number one, every word God speaks becomes law. If God is so powerful, why couldn't he just snap his finger and solve the problem? Adam messed up because of what I'm going to show you right now. Number two, God will never violate his word. Number three, God cannot deny his word. Number four, God and his word are one. Number five, God's holiness obligates him to keep his word. Number six, God himself must watch to perform his word because of his integrity. Whatever God said, he has to make sure it happens, even if it is killing you. Once he said it, he has to make sure it happens. Now listen, you're going to be blessed in a minute. We are going to leave this meeting laughing at death. See, when you understand this, understanding of God, you will understand why God had to become man. This is so sweet. Okay, watch this. Now, number seven, the fall and death of mankind was a result of God's faithfulness to his word. We were put under death because God is faithful to what he said to himself. He said, if you disobey me, you will surely die. God cannot break his word, and he had to make sure it is performed. Number eight, God had to make sure death fulfilled its purpose, because God cannot lie. Number nine, something and someone had to die to protect God's integrity. God says to Adam, if you eat from this tree, I'm giving you my word, you will surely die. You will activate death, and death will kill you. Now God has a challenge. If man disobeyed his word, then something has to die. If you understand this, you will never be stupid again, and your faith will make more sense than any religion in the world. Listen, God cannot violate his word, so he tells Adam, you have to die. So God has Adam, a human being. What is a human being? A spirit in a dirt body. God told this spirit being in a dirt body, the day you disobey me, you will activate death that's already in you, and it will kill you. Now, God's issue is he cannot violate what he said. Whatever he says becomes law to him. So, now listen, this is deep. Oh, don't miss me. God didn't say that to a spirit. He said it to a spirit in a body. If God had said it to a spirit, if you told the spirit you will surely die, then to solve the problem, all he'd have to do is kill a spirit. But he said it to a human, a spirit in a body. He didn't say, the day you eat, the spirits will die. He said, the day you eat, you who? You human. You human will surely die. Now watch this. Don't ignore this last statement. Whatever dies has to be the same thing I said would die. So if God, who is spirit, is going to decide he has to kill something, and instead of killing you, he would kill himself. But he didn't say he would just kill a spirit, but he would kill a spirit in a body. That if God is going to take the bullet for you to stay true to his word, he cannot come down as God alone. He has to become a man. The purpose of Good Friday. Number one, God decided to fulfill his word to himself through himself. Good Friday is God carrying out sentence on himself so you don't have to do jail time. Number two, God decided to satisfy the demands of his own faithfulness himself. He says, I've got to be faithful. I've got to kill something. Now I'm supposed to kill you, human, a man, but I love you too much, so I decided to kill myself. Good Friday is the manifestation of God's love for you. Because Good Friday is God telling man, ah, you come down and let me take your place. And God says, you go free. You go free, man. You are free. He says, now death, kill me. Death, I told you that if this man messed up, you have to kill man. I told you that. I'm God. So what I'll do is I'll become man. And once you kill me, they are free. Praise God. Hallelujah. Just give him a thanks. See, listen, this ain't complicated, but you have to understand God's problem. Number three, God decided to kill himself so that he would not have to kill man. But he had to become man so his word would be exact. You remember The Passion of the Christ? Mel Gibson produces The Passion, and everybody is upset. Now let me ask you a question. If all the cancers in the world were in one body, how would that body look? If all the headaches were in one head, how would that head look? If every sneezing cold and sinus infection were in one nose, how would that nose look? If all the AIDS were in one body, how would that body look? If every growth in your breasts were in one man's chest, how would that chest look? If every single cyst in your body was in him, how would he look? No wonder why the Bible says he was not one that we desired to look at. Gibson, you didn't do it as bad as it really was. The Bible says he bore our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes he healed all of us. As he hangs on the cross, people pass by as they shake their heads in disgust and mock him. Every single sin and result of sin was in that one body. Receive healing now. In the name of Jesus. Go ahead, just raise your hand. Just thank him. Give him a praise. He is the source of our healing. Hallelujah. Everything is coming out of your body right now in the name of Jesus. We didn't want to look at his body, Isaiah said. He was stricken of God. It was God's will that he be bruised and crushed with pain. He was bruised and crushed by God, not by Jews. Ain't no Roman killed God. Jesus says, no man takes this life. Then he says, for this cause I came into the world to give my life as a ransom for many. To give my life. You ain't taking it. I come to pay a bill, he says. These guys are just the accountants. The Sanhedrin Council and the Roman government was simply the accountants. He came to pay the bill, and they wanted to make sure it was paid. Listen to me. Don't you ever do foolishness on Good Friday, because it was a big payday for you. It's a holy day for the rest of your life because you understand what Jesus did. He took your place. The death of Jesus was God's judgment of man on himself. I put it to you that God became our substitutionary penalty. He said, don't kill them, death, kill me. And to make sure I qualify, I'll become like them. So you can't say I cheated and killed a spirit only. I want to show you something. You see these plants here? The way you kill a plant is you separate it from the soil. Then it is no longer attached to its source. It has forsaken. There was a detachment between the two. So Jesus said, look, I'm going to substitute for them. The worst experience for Jesus was not the whip. It wasn't the nails. It wasn't the vinegar, which he refused. It wasn't the slapping and the spitting in his face. Anybody could take that. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said to his disciples, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. He was talking about the cup. He wasn't talking about them beating me, spitting on me, calling me names. He was thinking about for one brief moment, he had to be separated from himself. That's why on the cross, he didn't talk loud. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Very calmly. He told the thief, today you'll be in paradise. Very calmly. Woman, behold your son. John, take care of mom. Very calmly. I thirst. Very calmly. But the Bible says, when he made this next statement, it says he screamed in a loud voice, Father! This part! I can't take this! Why have you forsaken me? When Adam messed up, he detached from you. He being your Father, Source, Creator, God. So God decides, I'm going to pay the price. I'm going to have to be forsaken by myself. I hope you weep tonight because You made God separate himself from himself. Father, why hast thou detached yourself from me? I can't take this. Why? And the father says, we've got to pay the price for them. Let me tell you what hell is. Hell ain't fire. Hell is being separated from God. A plant does not want soil. A plant needs soil. The human spirit does not want God. Imagine never finding him. It's called eternal frustration. That's what hell is. Hell is eternal separation from the thing you need the most. And that's why you've got to come to Jesus today. You've got to. You ain't stupid enough to stay away from Jesus. Let me tell you why. Because he separated himself so you don't have to be separated. He forsook himself so we could be put back in the soil. Good Friday is God dividing himself to put you together. Good Friday is God separating himself to unite you. When somebody is standing next to you and you are singing to Jesus, you shouldn't care what they think anymore because they don't understand what you understand what he did for you. That's why we sing to him. The rose was crushed, but he had us on his mind. It was not just about a tree. It was about you. Write this down, please. Good Friday was necessary to save us from a bad eternity. Can you imagine? One day solved eternity. One day, Good Friday, solved eternity's problem for you. You don't have to be separated from God anymore because of one day. I was listening to a song yesterday, all because of Jesus. All because of Jesus, we are healed. All because of Jesus, we are redeemed and restored. All because of Jesus, we get our dignity back. Thank God for Good Friday. Don't you ever treat this day lightly again. Because this day is the most important day in history. Because this day, God solved sin. He took the power of sin out of death. We therefore could walk in the face of death. And like Paul says, we do not grieve as those who have no hope. Because the dead who die in Christ shall rise again. He loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave himself. And if you can believe on what he did for you, you shall be saved. If you haven't received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I invite you to pray with me in faith. Dear Heavenly Father, I understand and accept the truth that you are my source and the manufacturer of my life. I acknowledge that I need you just as the plant needs the soil from which it came. I therefore submit myself to the Lord Jesus Christ and receive forgiveness of all my sins. I accept your promise of the Holy Spirit right now and rejoice that I can be reconciled and restored to the source of my life with the full guarantee of eternal life. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, amen. Go ahead and just give him a thanks. Just thank him. Thank him for paying the price. Meditate on Good Friday for yourself, just for a moment. Pray to him and just thank him. You might want to just lift your hand and thank him. Go ahead, just feel free. For the first time, just dig down deep for a couple minutes and just find the thank you for him. And thank him for the price. Thank him for the cup. You don't have to die with fear because death has no sting. You are free from death if you are under Christ. If you are watching this program, God's love for you is boundless. You cannot explain the love that God shows us in Calvary. He took the bullet for you so you could go free. He took the electric chair so you could leave prison. He died so you could live. This is the story of Good Friday. We thank you, Jesus.